Chapter 4, Student Becomes Teacher. I touched the two gold bangles around my neck, a gift from Zekara in recognition of my continuing education with her. They always made me feel better. She'd proven to be a better teacher than Celestia, in some ways. She never lied to me, or kept a secret, and even explained things without asking just because she thought I'd be curious. There were things I'd never really learned, like how to pass through thick plants without disturbing them, or her astounding sense of where plants and animals were around her. I was making do with magic, and she encouraged me. She liked it when I came up with my own solution. It was why I respected her, and why she was my friend. She didn't judge me. A pony across the street glanced at me. I suddenly felt self-conscious, turning away and walking quickly. I hated going into town. I pulled my cloak more tightly around my body. It was ragged after years of living in the forest, and even with the sewing lessons Granny Smith had given me, the thick material was worn through in places until it was almost like cheesecloth. I wasn't a vain pony, and I was starting to get more comfortable coming into town, but I really didn't want other ponies looking at me. Today was special, and I'd have to put up with it. I knocked on the door and glanced at the building I'd come to. It might have been the strangest place in town, like a giant version of the gingerbread castles ponies would make around Hearth's warming eve. The door opened wide, quickly enough to surprise me. Welcome to Sugarcube Corner. I found myself looking down at a bouncing pink pony, whose exuberance quickly drained as she looked at me. She squeaked and bolted, running away. I could hardly blame her. I was a scary witch, after all. I let myself in and looked around. The party was in full swing, and everything smelled like sugar. I didn't plan on staying for long, but I'd promised that I'd show up. Applejack had grown a lot in the last few years. She was nearly as tall as I was, and she'd only just become a teenager. I trotted over to where she was laughing with a few other foals, probably from her class at school. Ponies had started to notice me. I heard the chatter die down as I stalked across the brightly lit room like a living shadow. Applejack, I said, using a minor spell to give my voice echo and depth. I saw ponies start to cower. I have come for you. It's the Pony of Shadows, screamed the pink one, running upstairs. Oh, hey Sunset, Applejack said, totally unperturbed. She held out a cup. Want some punch? I snorted with laughter and dropped the voice spell, lowering my hood so I didn't look quite so much like the pale pony of death. Nothing scares you, does it? I took the cup, and put a wrapped box in her hoof. Here? Happy birthday, Applejack. You didn't have to get me nothing, Sunset, she smiled. I'm just glad we got you to come out of those woods for a spell. For a spell? Nah, mostly I do my spells in the woods, I retorted. Besides, it's your birthday. I didn't want to be the pony who shows up with empty hooves and gets free snacks out of it. She started unwrapping the box. It had taken me a while to get everything together. I don't exactly do a lot of shopping these days. Inside was a sealed wooden box, the edges coated in wax. It's a zebrakin harvest charm, I explained. I know you don't like mixing apples and magic, but this is more like a tradition for good luck. If you plant it in a field, it'll help protect the trees from rot and insects. That's a mighty thoughtful gift, Applejack smiled. But it wouldn't have nothing to do with when you took an apple from the wrong bushel and found a worm in it, would it? I can still taste it, I shuddered. It had almost put me off apples, until Granny Smith had made her famous apple butter and peanut brittle sandwiches for lunch, after which I found I rather liked apples again. Thank you, Sunset, she said, hugging me for a moment. We're just about to cut the cake. You want to stay and do TH honors? I shook my head, looking at the candlelit cake. I didn't want to be anywhere near cake. Too many bad memories. Sorry. I should go before I scare the rest of your guests off. You enjoy yourself, Applejack. I gave her a quick hug in return before turning to leave, replacing my hood as I walked towards the door. I heard conversations start again as I walked outside. It didn't hurt. It wasn't like they were ponies I knew. It was just a reminder that I wasn't like them. I was almost a decade older and an outsider. I sighed and tried not to think about the pink pony that had run away from me. I should have enjoyed it. I was trying to cultivate the image of a big, scary witch after all. I shook my head and trotted quickly, pulling shadows around myself to try and hide as I made my way out of town and back towards the safety of the Everfree. It didn't hurt. 4 years. I'd been imposing on Zekera for almost 4 years now. I needed to find my own place. Zekera had explored more deeply into the woods than I had. There was a dense core to the Everfree, a center where all the twisted ley lines and chaotic magic centered. I'd gotten close a few times and seen the ruins of a castle, but had stayed away. Today, I was going to overcome that fear. I wasn't going to build some shack in the woods if I could find existing shelter to use, and the old castle might just be what I needed. With all of the strange magic around the place, though, I was going to have to be careful. Being careful, today, meant finding my way through the brush without burning it down. A few firestorm spells would definitely have made it easier, but in this case maybe easy was going to take a backseat to caution. One thing it would have helped with, though, was seeing more than two hooves in front of my face. I growled and tried to push through the thick fronds of the ferns in front of me, got my bad hoof painfully tangled in vines, started cursing, and lost my balance when I tried to pull myself free. I twisted and rolled, having hit a downslope, tumbling down the incline and fighting to slow myself as rocks and branches bruised me. Then I was abruptly free. Free falling, I mean. I squeaked as I realized I was falling into a deep gorge, started to panic, and decided I'd rather go out with a bang than a splat. I charged up a teleport spell and flung myself towards a rickety-looking bridge strung across the ravine. I wasn't sure what surprised me more, when the spell worked or when the bridge held my weight. Teleport spells failed too often for comfort in the Everfree. I'd appeared a few hooves above it and landed so heavily on my back I was sure I was about to go right back down into the gorge I'd escaped. Somehow, the wood and ropes didn't break, and I was left holding onto them for dear life as the unbalanced ridge swung back and forth from the force of my impact. "Why can't I ever catch a break?" I whispered, as I waited for the oscillations to cease. The pendulum-like movement slowed, and I nearly felt safe, though it still creaked and twisted slightly in the wind above the steep drop. "Okay, Sunset. It's just a bridge," I said, taking a deep breath and standing. Everything shifted and moved, and I squeaked and threw myself down again. I edged along, almost crawling, and made a critical mistake. I looked over the edge. It's funny, I don't remember being afraid of heights before I left Canterlot. Maybe a long fall and a near-death experience does that to a pony. I felt dizzy as I looked at the drop into darkness, the bottom too far away to make out in the gloom. I squeezed my eyes shut and grabbed the guide rope. "Just keep moving," I told myself. "You're more than halfway across, the only way out is through. You're the strongest unicorn. Even if you fall, you've got plenty of ways to save yourself. You can use a feather spell. Or summon a bunch of pillows. Or even use a precisely timed fireball to break your fall." My hoof slipped as I tried to step onto a board that had gone missing. I screamed. Why did I ever want stupid bucking wings in the first place? I yelled, to no one in particular. I gave up on the bridge, vanishing in a burst of light and reappearing on the other side. Unfortunately, I had been upset and not thinking too clearly when I cast the spell. I came out on the other side upside down and covered in soot. I landed on my face. "Ow," I said, softly. All my major organs seemed to be in place, and I was across the gorge. Two good pieces of news. Note to self, replace old bridge with something sturdier. Made out of stone. I shook myself and looked back at the bridge. Now that I wasn't busy being terrified, I could see that it was incredibly old. If it wasn't for the enchantments I could see on it, it would have fallen to dust long ago. Seemed like a sign that I might be on the right track. You didn't build a bridge like that unless it led somewhere. Speaking of tracks, I mumbled, digging at the ground. The undergrowth here was different, all moss instead of grasses and ferns. I found out why very quickly. The moss was a thin layer over cobblestone. I smiled and followed the path, the moss making a clear trail. It was actually surprisingly pleasant. There weren't any signs of huge predators here, and there was a certain sense of quiet contemplation. As the castle came into view, though, I shivered. I wasn't afraid of it. I wasn't afraid of anything, excepting the princess, and the various ways the princess might find me. But the way it was ruined, that sense of serenity. It suddenly felt like I was walking through a graveyard. Maybe I'd learned more from Zechara than I thought. She'd often spoken of a spirit world, a place of dreams and death, and if there was such a place it felt like it was very close at hoof here. As I walked, I saw other paths branching away, stones and heaps of rubble around me and hidden among the small trees. Had it all been a city once? I didn't remember hearing anything about a major city here. I scanned the area for magic as I made my way to the castle. There were traceries of old magic, more like ghosts of titanic spells than anything still active, lingering traces of what must have been apocalyptic sorceries. Getting into the castle was easy enough. There were no guards, the doors were open and unused, and even if they hadn't been, the roof had crumbled away long ago. There was a complex network of wards stretched across it, mostly spells of preservation, the more powerful wards having worn away over time until their strongest effect was to push dangerous animals away. Things were looking up. If the wards would keep me from being eaten in my sleep, this was definitely the place to be. I pushed a door open, the hinges giving out. It crashed to the ground with a sound like thunder, raising a huge cloud of dust. "Home sweet home," I said to myself. It was some kind of foyer area, dominated by an odd stone ori. Amazingly well preserved, but I couldn't tell what it was supposed to represent. Maybe it would make sense to a classical art scholar. I walked past it and through a hallway almost entirely open to the elements, the wall having crumbled to nothing. When I pushed the next door open, I started laughing. I couldn't help it. Of all the places to go. I snorted, walking inside. It was a throne room. And hanging from the walls were images of a bright sun and a white horse. Of course. It was just my luck. Try to escape from Celestia and end up in her old home. "It's probably the last place she'd look," I muttered, looking at the ancient tapestry. Even the spells hadn't preserved it perfectly, the colors starting to fade and the edges turning ragged. I was so absorbed by melancholy thoughts that I didn't notice something strange until I turned around. There were two thrones. And for every image of Celestia, there was one of another, her equal and opposite. Lunar images instead of solar symbols. I trotted up to the thrones and looked at them. They were nearly equal. "Two thrones. Two princesses," I muttered. "What does that mean?" It wasn't something I was going to solve staring at rocks. I explored the rest of the castle and quickly found something that made me almost faint. A library. Thousands of books, impossibly well preserved. And they'd been abandoned for ages. They were mine. All mine. "I might just be the luckiest pony alive," I said to myself. I started looking through the books, not taking any yet. I'd have all the time in the world for that. There's the Poneep scriptures. And the Book of Megan. They've even got the Clover manuscript. I grinned widely as I danced down the aisle. There was nothing that could ruin my day. Or at least that's what I thought, until my saddlebag started buzzing. I reacted with the appropriate grace of a mighty sorceress, apprentice shaman, and scary witch. That is to say, I made a choked squeaking sound, threw my saddlebags across the room, and ran for cover like they were about to explode. Look, it made sense at the time. I'd been mixing a lot of potions lately, and when your potions started shaking and glowing and you didn't expect it, you either reacted quickly or you ended up turning green for a week. Or into a stallion. I didn't want to even think about that incident if I could help it. When I realized what the noise actually was, I got even more worried. I'd kept my journal because, well, it was one of the few things that was really mine. It was stupid, sentimental, and if I wasn't in the Everfree, Celestia probably could have used it to find me in seconds. She hadn't written to me since I'd left, either. Had she found me while I was in town? Had I made a critical error? Why would she try to contact me now? I didn't move for long minutes, watching the sky and the doors. If it was the precursor to an ambush of some kind, I was going to be prepared. Sweat dripped down my face and neck. My saddlebag still vibrated and buzzed softly. No sign of any teleportation. No alerts being sent from the ancient castle's broken wards. There was nothing to do but see what the princess had written. I kept my guard up and dragged the book out of my saddlebags from as great a distance as I could manage. I opened it to the last page and there was nothing there. Was the book broken? Had the strange magic of the Everfree messed up the enchantment somehow? I flipped through it, confused. That's when I saw it. Notes written in the margins, in hoof writing I didn't recognize. It seems this is the journal of a previous student. Possible study guide? Pyrokinesis. The princess hasn't taught me any fire spells yet. These notes on proper usage should be useful for independent study. This only happened a few years ago. Where is this Sunset Shimmer now? Why didn't the princess ever tell me about her? There were a few other technical notes, mostly around where I'd copied useful information scavenged from different books together into easily referenced tables. It was pretty obvious what had happened. I'd been replaced. Again. And this time she wasn't even pretending it was something else, like when she tried to make Cadence and I get along. I guess it had to happen sooner or later. I just thought it would take more time. I rubbed at my eyes. Yeah, I was starting to cry. I mean, I knew I'd messed up, but I still thought it would take more time than that. So much for when Celestia had told me that power like mine only came around once in a generation. I admit, part of me still cared. I mean, the princess was the closest thing I had to a family, and now that she had a new student it was like I'd lost even that. Maybe I'd just been paranoid because I still wanted to think I mattered to Celestia. Clearly that wasn't as close to the truth as I'd like. I put the book down, watching as more notes appeared. What to do? Throw the book away? It'd be the smart thing to do. If the princess had a new student, it had to mean she wasn't looking for me anymore. I could make a clean break of it. I tried to get back to cataloging books, but it wasn't helping. That feeling kept nagging at me, the sense of loss and resentment. I went back to the journal. Part of me wanted to hate this nameless replacement. It would be easy. She'd taken what should be mine and. I groaned and collapsed onto the floor. What's the point? I mumbled. She doesn't even know who I am. It's Celestia's fault, not that new student's. She probably kicked me out because she already had a replacement in mind. I rolled onto my back and looked up at the sky. I couldn't ignore it. I had to do something. I pulled the book over and flipped back to the blank page I'd checked before. It's been a long time since I did this. I wouldn't use this as a study guide. You'll just make the same mistakes I did. And don't tell her about this. Sunset Shimmer. I sighed and closed the book, immediately regretting it. It was stupid to think that the princess wouldn't find out about it. She'd probably given her new student my journal in the first place. I'm sure she'd be telling her all about how I'd gone into dark magic and that I'd been so disappointing that she'd ordered Everpony to forget about me. I was surprised when there was a reply a few minutes later. I didn't know this was a communication tool. I'm sorry for writing in your journal. I took it from the princess' room without asking. I thought it was a spell book, but then I started reading and it was a journal and I thought it would be a way to actually get ahead of the princess in lessons and I'm sorry. I snorted. At least she'd taken it without permission. It meant the princess might not find out for a while. I was starting to calm down when another message appeared. Are you another student? I didn't know the princess had other students. My name is Twilight Sparkle. I could have just ignored her. Should have, really. I was kind of amused, though. I was. She kicked me out after I failed a test. If you don't want to get kicked out, you probably shouldn't tell her you contacted me. That was actually solid advice, as far as I was concerned. Celestia seemed to like her students to stay in the dark. The less this twilight sparkle wrote to me, the more likely she wouldn't be thrown out onto the street. Just because you failed a test? Why would she do that? What happened? I promise I won't tell her, I just have to know. Her horn writing was becoming more and more scratchy. I could barely read it towards the end of that message. I was in pretty deep now. A second message came in while I was deciding what to do, another almost indecipherable plea for help. Seems like I'd have to give her at least something to go on. I'm a bad pony who did bad things. We had a fight. If you want to stay on her good side, just take whatever she gives you and never ask for more. I wanted things I wasn't allowed to have, and she kicked me out just like that, and she hates me enough that she wouldn't even tell ponies about me. Don't make the same mistakes I did. There was a long delay after that. I put the book down. Maybe she'd finally come to her senses. I didn't feel much like reading today, though. I tried to think about other things I could do. Should do. I needed to let Zechariah know I'd found a place to stay, I needed to start sorting the books, I needed to get a bunk together. All I could do right now was just sit, though. I didn't want to do anything but curl up and not do anything. A message came through the book. I glanced at it, and my lip curled into a smirk. If you're a bad pony, does that mean you'd give me answers to test questions?